I want to start with someone who had nothing whatsoever to do with the steel band. It was a band leader in the beginning of the 20th century. Very prolific person. I mean, his band recorded thousands of records. Who made a statement that even he at the time thought was exaggerated. And I won't read it because I'm sure you can. Essentially, he was talking about Edison's invention. Everyone thought he was just being, you know, kind of wild and so on, especially since his band recorded so much, thousands of records. And now, a little over 100 years later, it actually is quite true. More and more, we are consumers rather than producers of music. More and more, something that was a collective art form, that was produced collectively, as he described, is now a solitary consumption. You see people with earphones and sort of huddled in their solitary lives. That is the sort of global context within which I want to speak about the steel band movement. So that is where I'll now start. And as the person who introduced me said, I'll start with a story. It's a story about, it's a story of a memory, actually, because it's something I've been told so many times that even though I don't remember it, I sort of remember it. My mother tells me that they took me to the first panorama. That would have been in 1963, and I would have been 8 years old. And they're doing whatever they're doing, looking at the bands, listening, whatever. And all of a sudden, my father says, "Wake him." And mommy says, "Where, man, I've got that blasted boy. Where he go lost? He gone." And as they're about to press the panic button, someone said, "Look him there on the stage, he pushing a pan." I've heard it enough times, so it almost seems like a memory. There is a memory. I do recall, perhaps a year or two later, actually pushing a pan. And I definitely remember it because it was such an extremely profound, visceral experience. I remember the pleasure was so deep that while I was enjoying this thing, I was thinking about doing it again next year. Incidentally, next year, a rock ran over my foot and nearly broke my toe. And I continued. So many years later, I discovered that was almost a rite of passage for young boys at the time. This is actually a bit before my time. This would have been about 1958. But you could see in the midst of it, the little boys pushing pan. And what I do recall of that experience is, I think, quite a general thing, is that I and we encounter the national instrument, pan, first of all, as an experience of belonging, rather than an experience of music. It is an experience of belonging to something that is very big, very powerful. At the time when I was a child, they were on the streets, and there was these enormous organisms which was pouring out, you know, a torrent of music, and the little small boy was a part of it. It was just a tremendous grandeur. It was you were part of something much bigger than you were. Now, that relationship to the production, the doing, the making of music is not unique to pan, of course. I mean, certainly all music has some element of it, and especially the music that has come out of the Americas, the music that was by and large developed by the African Americans, and by African Americans, I mean North America, South America, and the islands in between. And the most common relationship, the most common way of participating in this music was dance, and it still is. But again, the steel band movement took that a bit further. You see, the dance we developed was a dance that was itself percussive. We call it a chip, and you should know it. You kind of go so. Because what happened is that at the time, bands were too small for you to hear them. You might hear the iron, 30 people playing, and there are 1,500 people in All Stars. So what you're actually dancing to is the sound of your own feet. So our dance specially choreographed to scrape your feet along the tarmac. And when you hear 1,000 people do that, it actually seemed like a really very, very elegant form of music. But of course, things have changed, and the steel band movement has developed different ways to invite your participation, or rather seduce your participation. And it does so by bringing you into its home. Now, we take this for granted. We all go, you know, in this, you go in phase two, you go in Desperados, you go in Silver Stars, All Stars, Fontclair, wherever, and you hang out there and you drink a beer and you lime and you cock up your foot and you see your friends and so on. And you hear them play the first 5 bars of the tune 50 times, and you don't even listen to it anymore. But you had a good time, so you come back the next night and you see some more people and blah, blah, blah. And you don't realize what a weird thing you are doing. Because performing artists actually practice and rehearse privately. And when they have their act perfect, they come out and charge you money to see it. But the steel bands, they invite you into their home, you know, not when formal dinner, you come over to dinner, come over for breakfast and your pajamas and your barefoot and you cock up your foot and your lime and so on. And that is how they begin to inveigle you into their camp. And this is very important because, again, here it distinguishes itself from all of the myriad other forms of music, and beautiful music that have come out of the New World, you know, the rock and the rock and roll and the samba and the salsa and the dancehall and the reggae and all of that, because they all have been spread by consumption. People hear them, you like it, you buy the record, you buy the CD, you download the MP, you know? Pan spread by starting little steel bands all over the world. Very, very strange. And it is this process of encouraging people to do. Now, the first thing is that it brings you into his home and it makes you believe that this thing, it's real easy. Real easy. And indeed it is. In many countries, not Trinidad, but many countries, Pan is actually the instrument of education in primary schools. Because if any of you have tried to learn other instruments, you know, guitar, trumpet, saxophone, you know, harp, they hurt your fingers. They require forms of manual dexterity that are difficult, boring, painful to master. Pan, well, you know, from the time you're about 6 months old, you could pong. So what happens, realistically, you go in the pan yard, and from day one, you go home that evening, having learned to play a tune. Simple, but the pleasure of actually producing the music is what will inveigle you on. Now, that is just one part, because the steel band, you know, being the sort of ultimate, for us, homemade instrument, developed a sort of homemade pedagogy. In other words, how it is taught. And it is like each one teach one. You go in the pan yard and you say, boy, I want to learn. You go by that fella there and you look over your shoulder and you try a thing and you don't understand. And you see people from the highest to the lowest and looking over somebody's shoulder and seeing how you do it. As in the photograph there. And what that does, it not just makes the learning a very informal and closer to pleasurable experience, which distinguishes it from a lot of formal teaching. I mean, Trinidad and Tobago has a generation of women who were brought up on arpeggios and scales on Saturdays, and the day they stop having to do those things, they stop playing piano. A whole generation. So it's a different approach to learning an instrument that the steel band evolved, which is a lot more relaxed. Sometimes it's a bit too relaxed. You know, you're supposed to start at 8 o'clock and by 10:30, people now drifting in. And everything has its drawbacks. But what it does is it creates a kind of bonding between members of the band. We aren't just people who practice at home, learn our parts, and come out like an orchestra with the sheet music and we play it together, and the only time we're together is when we're in front of the audience. No, you're there every night, you grumble, you quarrel because so-and-so late and you go home and this and you lime on. And it becomes a family. Now, this idea of the steel band as a family, it's not something that is just a metaphor. It is very, very literally true in the sense that, as I will perhaps, as I'll mention later, when you are in a band, and you could take any band, for whatever reason, you decide you like Pamberry, Fun Clear, whatever. Once you are in the band, you are in a family. You could be from outer space. They will be your family. And if anyone ever tried to take liberties with you, you know you will have a band on your side. And that is quite remarkable if you realize that in some bands, there are people from Tokyo and people from Sheffield and all over. You are in a family. And what that means is that the learning is through pleasure and through love. Now, if you think what this involves, when we think of music, music is also a very weird thing, eh? Very, very weird, because a succession of sounds, no words attached, can make us happy or sad or thoughtful or suspended waiting for something else. And this direct connection with our emotions, this amazing and very powerful ability that music has to evoke emotions, to transport us, both physically and emotionally. A lot of neuroscientists, a lot of people are baffled by it. Why? I mean, Darwin and all would say, what's the use of this thing? But it is there, and it is so powerful. You know, no human society known has not had music. And I think it is becoming a more common understanding that we evolved this responsiveness to music as a way of bonding. I mean, the earliest bonding we experience is, of course, the bonding with the mother. Everywhere in the world, there's a language called motherese. True, academic, the motherese. But you know how it is. It's much more lilting, much more higher pitch, much more, quote-unquote, sing-song. Because infants, long before they understand words, understand tones. Similarly, and on a bigger scale, I mean, if you could just throw your imagination to, you know, the Neolithic clan huddling in a cave around a fire, you know, fully aware that any day or any minute could mark its extinction at some much larger, more ferocious creature. And the idea of singing together, I don't know if you've ever had a campfire sing-along or singing with a group of friends. The bonding that occurs by producing music together is a very, very profound human experience. And there are evolutionary theorists who propose what is to me a very appealing argument that this bonding function is what enhanced the development and the survival of the species. But how does it work? I mean, to summarize it, and in a sense I kind of touched on it before, there are two things. There's, first of all, the synchronization of our movements. We dance together, or we do things together. We push, 1, 2, 3, heave. We march together, and our bodies, as they become synchronized, we begin to be part of a bigger organism. Some of our musicians, when they say, move to the left, and we all move to the right, and get something and weave, and all of us doing it. It creates that, you know, at the moment, that togetherness. And that the rhythm does that. At the same time, what I spoke about earlier, the emotional synchronization, which the melody does, it means not only are we physically synchronized, but we are emotionally synchronized. You know, as I say, we're reading from the same page, the same poem on the same page. And these are some of the ways which perhaps neurologically music bonds us together by synchronizing our emotions. You know, I like you and you like me. There's a kind of togetherness which is much better than I like you and you can't stand my guts. practically, a very practical thing. We know, we've seen it used. I mean, the examples, 1, 2, 3, heave, it's used in armies. I mean, marching together, synchronizing, singing together, very, very important, because what you try to create in a platoon is people, men, who might not have known one another a year ago, so tightly knit that one will die for the other. It is, and this synchronized, that's why they make their march, you know, march. Not for exercise. It creates that bonding, which is vital if an army is to do its trick of killing other people. That's what they call a primary group. Everybody know everybody. But music can do this on a much grander scale. A generation could be united by music. This is a picture of Woodstock. It, literally, a generation. People of my age in the Western world, everybody would have known certain songs and would have moved to certain music, whether they know whether from which country or whatever. And that bonding, we've seen almost every youth movement since the Second World War coalesced around some kind of music. Now, let's go back to the steel band, because I've shown two kinds of bonding. And even though the steel band in its early years had its fair share of fighting, it was never about fighting. It was always about music. And as a result, it accomplished something which is actually quite marvelous. Something which, again, like some of the things I mentioned, hopefully you've seen, but not realized quite the significance of it.
In a space of 15, 20 years, they went from just beating rhythm on thrown away garbage to having created an orchestra.
They were so driven and obsessed by this thing that they just took over their lives, and they gave it everything.
I eat pan, I sleep pan, I live pan. That's my life.
It was persecuted by the police and the marines and the military on the orders of the British colonials.
When you hear police, you have to run.
I had speed. So I got speed, man.
で、ここの場所でトリニダードでは本当にそれを感じますね。電波があったからみんなとコミュニケーション取れたのはすごく感じます。
A million fathers and mothers there.
From the time I had the first note, that was the end of that. I could not stop after that.
I like it. I go be a fan, man, all the way.
Je pense qu'à partir du moment où on va se mettre à répéter, ça va être une grosse pression.
J'ai rien à dire, ça fait 20 ans que j'attends
ça. Let's go!
One final word, what I hope that would have brought out to you is that every form of social exclusion, race, class, ethnicity, religion, education, nationality, gender. There was a 9-year-old girl and she's in phase 2, age, most difficult. every single form of human exclusion has been transcended in the steel band movement without breaking stride. In that regard, it is a unique institution in the world. And I think we should always be aware of that and cherish what we've created. Thank you.